give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will bow down and hail you as King. I will serve you. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. Lord, you're worthy of my praise. Lord, you're worthy of my praise.
Twickenham, how are we doing this morning? Woo. How are we doing in the balcony? I didn't hear what they said, and I don't want to know. So, hey, welcome. If you're a guest this morning, thanks for coming out to be with us. As is probably already apparent, we're relaxed, so you should too. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming. If you have a prayer concern, there's a card on the seat in front of you. If you'll write that prayer concern down, we will pray over that. Tomorrow morning, if you want it private, let us just indicate that on the card. If you want the whole church to pray about it, indicate it. And when the collection plate passes later on in the service, you can drop the card in there. We're just really glad you're here. If you're looking for a church home, we are always looking for new family members. In fact, I want to welcome one of our newest, Gene Marquez. Are you in here? There is Gene Marquez. Welcome, Gene. Glad to have you. Give him a big hand. Coolest thing happened this past week with, I know I said it'd be quick, but sorry. I know I did. So Tuesday I get this call from my brother that my parents have been in an auto accident, and you've been awesome. Thank you for all your prayers and concern. They've made a lot of improvement. Mom's room is called the party room now at the hospital. People not on that floor are just going there because it's fun, and they have counselors for people who leave dad's room. So that's got to give you an idea. It's like Party City and Mordor. That's how their other rooms are. So anyway, so Tuesday I get a call from my brother that says there's been an accident, and so we're making plans. Couple of, 30, 40 minutes later, I get a text from Gene, and he says, I don't know why, but I feel prompted to pray for you and your family today. That was just really awesome, the Spirit working in that way. And so God is in the room. God is in the house. God is here. Let's stand. Let's have some praise time. I want to share a scripture with you. Go ahead and get on your feet. This is from Psalm 68. But may the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. May they be happy and joyful. Sing to God. Sing in praise of his name. Extol him who rides on the clouds. Rejoice before him. His name is the Lord. Let's praise him together.
Rise up, O men of God, have done with lesser things. Give heart and mind and soul and strength to serve the King of Kings. Rise up, O men of God, his kingdom tarries long. Bring in the day of brotherhood and end the night of wrong. Rise up, O men of God, the church for you doth wait. Her strength unequal to her task, rise up and make her great. Lift up the cross of Christ, tread where his feet have trod as brothers of the Son of Man. Rise up, O men all of God.
The God of the heavens, the Ancient of Days,
the God of our
fathers,
and God of our praise,
the
Alpha Omega, bow before you now. We come to lay our lives down. We will have no other gods before you. Nothing on earth will compete for your throne. You are the sovereign I am, and you reign in our hearts alone. We will exalt you on high forever, King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. We will have no other gods before you.
Our Maker, Creator,
Our rock of salvation,
so faithful and true,
we give all the glory
and honor to you,
for you alone are worthy of our never-ending love. We will have no other God before you. Nothing on earth will compete for your throne. You are the sovereign I am, and you reign in our hearts alone. We will exalt you on high forever, King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. We will have no other gods before you. We will have no other gods before you. Nothing on earth will compete for your throne. You are the sovereign I am, and you reign in our hearts alone. We will exalt you on high forever, King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. We will have no other gods before you.
Amen. If you'll be seated as we read from the Word this morning.
When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples,
"Who do people say the Son of Man is?"
They replied,
"Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets."
"But what about you? Who do you say I am?"
Simon Peter answered,
"You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God."
"Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven."
For the beauty of the earth, for the beauty of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our sacrifice of praise. For thy church that evermore lifteth hope.
sacrifice of love, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our sacrifice of praise.
Let the glory of your name be the passion of the church. Let the righteousness of God be a holy flame that burns. Let the saving love of Christ be the measure of our lives. We believe you're all to us. Only Son of God, sent from heaven, hope and mercy at the cross. You are church. Let the righteousness of God be a holy flame that burns. Let the saving love of Christ be the measure of our lives. We believe you're all to us. You're all to us. You're
this time of year. I love it for a lot of reasons. The weather as it starts to turn and as spring gets upon us. I also love it because I'm a sports fan, and this is a great time for sports. This is Masters weekend for the golfers out there. Major League Baseball just started. Opening day is exciting, but one of the things that I enjoy the most is NCAA basketball that just had its championship this past week. And I guess one of the reasons that I love that is because it is a true team sport. You know, if you watch the NBA at the professional level, I wonder sometimes if that's no longer the case. It seems to be very individualized, but at the college level, it's all about the team. And I enjoyed watching the championship game, which this past week was probably one of the greatest ever between North Carolina and Villanova. It was an exciting game to watch. But one of the things that really draws me in is the way that the kids on those teams commit to the team. You know, the coaches are masterful at getting them to buy in to what it takes to be a team and to work together as a team and to succeed as a team. And you hear words like commit and sacrifice and team above self. And you hear those concepts continually talked about throughout the tournament. And it really played itself out. North Carolina arguably had much better talent, but Villanova had the better team, and they prevailed in the game. It's that commitment to the team that just seems to compel them. I wonder if we've thought about what compels us as a church. You know, we sometimes think, I believe, that the Christian walk is an individual effort. And, you know, I think Scripture teaches us otherwise. It's a team sport. It really is. That's why the Apostle Paul, I think, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, went to great lengths to describe us not as a collection of individuals, but as members of a body, knit together by God Himself, empowered by the Spirit, with tools and skills and abilities and talents that He gives to contribute to one another being successful in this walk. It's a team sport. I wonder what compels us as a group. You know, the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 was talking to some people about some things that they had said against him and his ministry. And in response to that, listen to what he says and the wording that he uses. 2 Corinthians 5, verses 14 and following. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. It's Christ's love that compels us. And it's what compels us as a church family to put aside ourselves and to die to ourselves and to commit to God and to one another. That's what church family is about. It's a team sport. And this morning, we're going to participate together in something that we do each week to remember the body and the blood of our Savior, who went to the cross for us and died once for all. And it's because of that that we can die to ourselves and live forever for Him. Let's pray together. Our Father, as we prepare to take this meal together, we just pray that we could say, as Paul said, that it is Christ's love that compels us. And so, Father, we remember this morning the body of our precious Savior. We know that you have called us together as His body, and so we meet together as a family today. And we take this bread, and we remember the sacrifice that He gave on our behalf on the cross. I pray, Father, that you would work in our hearts as we do this together as a family. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's face, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilt. shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this cup that we're about to share together. And it reminds us of the precious blood of our Savior that was shed on the cross for our sins. Father, I pray that you would fill us this morning with the sense of the sacrifice that you made on our behalf, and that because of your love, that we in turn might sacrifice for one another. I pray that you'd strengthen us as a church family, even as we share this cup together. In Jesus' name, amen.
In my life, Lord, be glorified, be glorified. In my life, Lord, be glorified today. In my song, Lord, be glorified. today.
Hey, we have a couple of special folks with us today. They're not guests. Justin and Jonah Rieger are with us. Let's give them just a welcoming hand. And we support one mission work here at Twickenham, just one, and it's called Hacienda of Hope down in Cayambe, Ecuador. And they are, Justin and John are the directors down there. It's a children's home for children that have been abused and neglected. Sometimes we take care of them from now on. Sometimes we're able to reunite them with their families, but it's a tremendous work. There's also a school in a nearby community called the Hacienda of Hope Academy. Is that correct? And Jake and Tanya Wilson direct that program. They're not with us today, but Justin and John are, and we're really happy. Anytime they're in town, we want to get them up just for a minute, just to find out a little bit more about what's going on. A couple of weeks ago, you gave, you ready, over $250,000 on one Sunday for this ministry. That's how strongly we believe in this program. So we give the Lord a hand for that. And the first thing I want to find out about is back in December, I know that there was a, it was in Quito. Did Jesus happen in Quito? Was
in Cayambe.
Cayambe. Okay, so that's even closer. A baby was abandoned at a hospital, or abandoned somewhere in the city, and at the hospital, this happened in December. They named him Jesus. Okay, and so we learned about a little bit about that story. Can you give us an update on how he's doing? And this was like in their national media down there. He had police escorts. It was a big hairy deal. So. What happened?
We'd love to give a little update. First off, it's such an honor to be here with you guys here at home, here at the TWIC. It's great. We really appreciate the family we get from you guys, and it's just a joy to be here. We're relaxed too.
Yeah. Well, she's laughing because you said you called it the TWIC, and we have no idea what she's going to say when she starts because this. So, I'm not even worried.
We should be good. It was actually a tremendous blessing with baby Jesus coming in December. He did have a really horrific story to start off, being abandoned in an outdoor mall in Cayambe, and it was just a blessing that we were able to provide that kind of care that God had put us in the minds of those folks to be able to do that. This little child now has been growing with the Wilsons. Who are also the directors of the school, and he's got a nice set of hair. You and I would both be jealous. But he's got a great set of hair, and he couldn't have been placed with a better family. Yeah. The Wilsons have taken such great care of him. He's nice and fat, plump, and you couldn't ask for a better home.
I bet. I'm nice such and a blessing. Fat, so anyway. So, hey, you guys see, I know there are a lot of heartwarming stories like that. I know there are tons of them, and those are just, you live for those. But I also bet there are some stories that just break your heart. How are you and your team doing personally? Are you guys doing okay?
That's always a difficult piece for us. The stories are hard. The cases and the children we get don't come from easy backgrounds. It's on such a scale that they don't pick up all the kids that are in abusive situations. They don't pick up all the kids that are in neglect, and they really have a scale for that, which is really sad because of the lack of facilities like ours down there. But one of the things that we can do is just continue to be there. But it is, you bet, the stories are just heartbreaking. And so it's hard to deal with those a lot of times. Hard to know what to do with those.
Yeah.
You bet.
Jonah, what's your favorite story of God working in somebody's life right now? Is there one that just kind of really just obviously God's hand is in this, and it's such a blessing to watch what's happening? You've seen some real changes in somebody?
You didn't have that on your sheet.
No, I didn't.
Wait. I would say recently we received a almost 3-year-old, Emmeline, and when we got her, the CPS and the judge's office, everyone was scared of
CPS,
her
Child Protective
Child
Services.
Child Protective Services, okay. Excuse me. Yes. They were all scared of her father. He was into drugs. They had guns and all of that in the home. And so they gave us, like, we were thinking this family's really dangerous. Well, after talking with them, after talking with mom, it's actually, they're trusting us. I wasn't really scared of the little man that came to, you know, when y'all had the thing, Madison had the thing at the park, and he was kind of walking around with his big jacket acting all tough, and I was like, hey, I'm John, how are you? And anyways, because of that, they've warmed up to us, and it looks like we're going to be able to place her back in her home, and they're changing a lot of things. So as far as surprising things, we weren't expecting that, and God is working amazingly
awesome.
In that situation.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's been good.
There was a time when you guys were, now you grew up on the mission field, right, with your dad? Yeah?
That's what they tell me.
Okay. Okay. So yeah, she hasn't grown up yet, right? So you did not, though. You grew up in just in a regular American middle-class church, right?
I did. Okay. Lubbock, Texas.
Okay. So here's my guess is that there's somebody in this room right now that is thinking about one of these days, maybe I want to follow you guys onto the mission field. Maybe it won't be doing what you're doing. It won't be working with kids. Maybe it'll be doing something else. But somebody in the room is thinking about that. Maybe one of you guys is thinking about that. So what's something people could do right now, if we're looking a year, two, 3 years down the road, what could they do right now to prepare themselves to do the kind of work you're doing?
One of the easiest things is to jump on board on one of these mission trips coming down. Short-term missions are an easy intro into coming down and seeing what it's about. Letting it change and letting that kind of sit on you for a while and being able to dwell in that one of the really cool things is the mission field is for crazies just like us. And so if we can have a good time sharing Christ with what you're skilled at. And that's one of the amazing things about a children's home is that's our gift. That's one of the things that gets us excited. And we're just able to share Christ through that. And so I think one of the biggest things is don't be scared of who you are and being able to use Christ in what you want to do and who you are and what you're about. I think that's an amazing thing for us.
Okay, awesome, awesome. Anything in your heart you want to share with our church today?
That God is growing the children's home, and we appreciate your prayers. We appreciate the love that you send via Facebook, via email. It's been a crazy, crazy year. It's been crazy since, I guess, December. We've received almost 10 kids just since then. I wrote the missions committee, and I was like, I know we've been praying for more children, but please pray that God kind of sends them sporadically now, because this is just, it's been an amazing adventure, but God has given us what we've needed so far as help, and so we really, really crave and appreciate your prayers and the work you do alongside of us.
Awesome. Let's do something. Let's stand up. Oh, you were going to say something, too? Did the Lord put something on your heart?
He did. He said, okay. Thank you so much for letting us join in this amazing work with y'all.
Let's stand. I want us to have a prayer with Justin and Jonna and for their whole team, and you're standing, and it's our way of just being here with them. God, we're thankful for this courageous couple. For their love for you, we pray for just to continue to give them the strength and the passion, the protection they need. We're thankful for the Wilsons and everybody on the team down there. We are thankful for all these precious children that come to the Hacienda. We're thankful for the hope they find there. We pray that you would bless our folks who are working there with spirits that are resilient and strong and confident in the hope that we have through Jesus Christ, and that the strength and endurance they need will come from you through your Spirit. Protect them, bless them with all of the resources they need. Help us to be there for them in every way we can, and just take care of this precious couple as they travel. We love them, we commend them to your care, and we ask you to continue to bless them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing.
We believe in God the Father.
We believe in God the Father.
We believe in Christ the Son.
We believe in Christ the Son.
We believe in the Holy Spirit.
We believe in the Holy Spirit.
We are the church and we stand as one.
We are the church and we stand as one.
We believe in the Holy Bible.
We believe in the Holy Bible.
We believe in the virgin birth. The resurrection.
We believe in the resurrection.
The Christ one day will return to earth.
The Christ one day will return to earth.
Holy, holy, holy is our God.
sing because we believe.
We believe in the blood of Jesus.
We believe in the blood of Jesus.
We believe in eternal life.
We believe in eternal life.
We believe in his blood that frees us.
We believe in his blood that frees us.
To become the bride of Christ.
To become the bride of Christ.
Holy, holy, holy is our God. Worthy, worthy, worthy is our King. All glory and honor are his to receive. To Jesus we sing because we believe.
Holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy is our God. Worthy, worthy, worthy is our King.
Amen.
Be seated.
Seated. Hey, tonight, are we in here or in here? Okay, tonight at 5:30? 5 o'clock? Sometime this afternoon, we have our instrumental service, The Spring, and it's going to be in this room, and invite you to come be a part of that. It's an awesome time of praise to God in the kind of contemporary format. So 5 o'clock tonight in The Spring. What's our theme tonight?
Presence.
Presence. Thought maybe Steve Krieger was going to show us his slides from Israel. No? Okay. Presence tonight, 5 o'clock, The Spring. Come on out and be a part of that. With no more effort than it takes to find funny pictures of people at Walmart, some of us have wasted some time, I see. You can go online and read page after digital page of complaints, criticisms, and condemnations of the church. It is the low-hanging fruit of the internet. And there are basically three categories of criticism directed to the church. The first comes from people who have been hurt. The first category comes from people who have been hurt by the church. In my view, this category is entirely justifiable. I'm thinking about things like the child abuse scandals and subsequent cover-ups in the Catholic Church, or the extravagant scams of name-it and claim-it preachers who guilt people who can't afford it into helping them buy $60 million jet airplanes so they can spread the gospel faster. Show up at my door with a petition condemning those abuses, and I'll sign my name to it. Some of us in this room have been hurt by the church, or more likely, some of us watching online have been hurt by the church. When you needed grace, you got a punch in the mouth. When you needed somebody to stand between you and the consequences of a bad decision, you got a cold shoulder. I just want to acknowledge the reality that sometimes the church hurts people. And if you're one of the folks that have been hurt, I'm deeply saddened that happened to you. And I'm going to ask you to do something really hard. I'm going to ask you to forgive us or whoever hurt you. Not for us or for them, but for you, because it's killing you. Just asking you to consider that. But I do want to acknowledge that that's a justified criticism. Sometimes the church does hurt people. The second category of criticism is, I understand it, but it's not realistic. It's the hypocrisy complaint. You've heard this one. I don't like the church because it's full of hypocrites. On the one hand, it's reasonable to expect some consistency between what Christians say and how we live, especially since we're the ones who are typically calling people to a higher standard of behavior. And it is true that not everybody who claims to be a Christian actually lives like one, but often what people who level this criticism point to is not hypocrisy, but imperfection. They see a Christian make a mistake or fail in some way, and they go, you see, hypocrites. Here's the thing. There has only been one member of the church whose life consistently perfectly matched the teachings of the church. His name was Jesus. The rest of us are going to make mistakes. We're going to have a spotted record, every single one of us. We just sang a minute ago, we look forward to the time when we're saved to sin no more. We're not there yet. Okay, we're all going to make mistakes. That's one of the reasons that we're quick to point out that a prerequisite for being a member of the church is to admit that you're not perfect, to admit that you're a sinner. The church is full of broken people trying to put their lives back together. It's full of people who are not there yet and know it. It is not full of people who have it all together and live lives of complete consistency. And while I'm just being real honest here, can I just tell you, I suspect about 85 to 90% of the time, the hypocrisy complaint is nothing but a dodge. It's just easy to say, but I don't believe it. Nobody boycotts hospitals. Nobody boycotts record labels. Well, Christians do sometimes, but nobody boycotts movies or restaurants or fashion lines or automobile companies or book publishers because their mission statements say one thing and their employees do another. There's hypocrisy everywhere. And if you reject one institution because of its hypocrisy, in order to be consistent, you're going to have to reject every hypocritical institution. Otherwise, you're like those Occupy Wall Street protesters who use their iPhones to rail against corporate profits while wearing Abercrombie sweaters. And then there are the criticisms that just miss the point altogether. Church is boring. My parents made me go to church when I was young. Church starts too early. Church lasts too long. Church music doesn't connect with me. This variety of complaint misses the point because it makes two incorrect assumptions. The first incorrect assumption is that church is an event, like a concert or a movie or a theatrical production. Folks who level this criticism are confusing what happens between 10 and 11 on Sunday morning with the church. They could be more wrong, but not by much. This hour of the week is one of the times the church comes together. But this right here, what we're doing, is not church. This is the church at worship. Tomorrow morning, the church will be at school or at work or in the neighborhood. Church is just not an event. You can't schedule it on a calendar. You can't find it on a map. The truth is, you can't really even go to church. The other false assumption behind this category of criticism, I'll tell you what, it's more neatly summed up in a video. So just take a look at this. This is old, but still true. Watch this.
Imagine a church where every member is passionately, wholeheartedly, and recklessly calling the shots.
I have a busy work week, and by the time Sunday rolls around, I'm tired. So how about a church service that starts when I get there?
Can do. When you arrive, we begin.
This guy, he plays by his own rules. We want to find a church where if he starts screaming, we're not the bad guys, right? Come
here. Say no more. If your baby's screaming, you stay seated. The others around you can leave.
You know, financially, Sherry and I don't give a lot to the church, but we'd sure like to know who does.
All right, if you join now, you'll know what every person gives in detail.
When I'm in the church service, can my car get a buff and a wax?
Not just that, but an oil change and a tune-up.
Hey, how about tickets to the Super Bowl?
That's asking too much.
I'm serious. If I'm gonna join, I want tickets to the big game.
All right, you join now and we'll get you there.
I like a pony.
Look in your backyard. Me Church, where it's all about you.
Hey, I just got to tell you, I'm tempted just to say, won't you please come while together we stand and sing right here. So. A lot of folks think it's the job of the church to cater to their needs and preferences, their needs and preferences. And I don't mean to be ugly here. the church does not exist to entertain you or me or anybody else. The church is not here to assuage our boredom or alleviate our discomfort or accommodate our schedules. The church has a very specific purpose and mission, and making you and me or anybody else feel good is nowhere in that mission. So what is? Look in Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians is in the kind of the middle of the New Testament. Ephesians chapter 3. We're in a series right now called Identity, Who We Really Are in Christ, and the who, and the we that we are, that the title refers to, is both individual Christians and the collective we call the church. And Ephesians is the churchiest book in the Bible. So Paul, the apostle and author, is going to say something about the church here in these verses that even some of us are going to find a little bit hard to believe, much less those who criticize the church. So I want to get started in Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 7, all right? Verse 7, we're going to read verses 7 and 8. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ. First thing I noticed when I read that was that Paul mentions the gift of God's grace twice. He likes to talk about that. Grace comes up over 120 times in the New Testament, and 10% of them are here in Ephesians. Paul liked to talk about grace because, as he says here, he was less than the least of all the Lord's people. His sin was ever before him. He knew better than most that had it not been for the grace of God, he would have been lost. There's that prerequisite to being a member in the church, right? Recognizing that you don't deserve it. Recognizing your imperfection. Admitting that you're somebody that's missed the mark. You're a sinner. Acknowledging that. Paul does that. He does that beautifully here. We like to talk about grace too. We call grace God's unmerited favor. We say that grace is the smile on the face of God. Grace is getting what we need, not what we deserve. And all of that is true, but there's a lot more to it than that. Paul said that God's grace did not just save him. Look at verse 7 there. He says it made him a servant. I became a servant because of this grace. We didn't read this part, but in verse 1, he said God's grace made him a prisoner. Grace, now this is really important stuff here. Listen to this. Grace saved Paul from a lot of misery, but it also gave him a mission. Grace saved him from eternal pain, but it gave him a purpose. Grace delivered him from judgment, but it gave him a job. So what I think that teaches us is a much more robust concept of grace. Grace is more than your get out of hell free card. It not only frees us from something, it frees us for something. It does deliver us from eternal separation from God, and it puts us to work serving others and showing others the boundless riches found in Christ. Paul's already talked about this once back in chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. He says, "It is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves." It's a gift of God. There's that gift thing again. "Not by works, so that no one can boast, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus." Read these underlined words with me here. "Created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Grace saves you from your sins, but grace gives you a job. I want you to really get your arms wrapped around that. I want to get your mind open to this idea that grace does more than just save you from hell. It puts you to work. We are created in Christ. We're saved by grace, but we're created in Christ Jesus to work, to do good work. That's what grace does for us. The Bible does not know anything about a spiritually unemployed church member. So here's a question for you. You know grace saved you. To what part of the mission of Jesus does grace call you? I mean, Justin and Jonah felt the call, the call of grace to be on the mission field. Maybe that's what you're going to hear. Maybe that's the call you're going to receive. Maybe grace is going to call you to do that. Or maybe it's going to be something completely different. I don't know what it's going to be, but I'm asking you to think about it. You know that you were saved by grace. To what part of the mission of Jesus does grace call you? To what purpose is grace pointing you? What job does grace want to give you? If the church is not an event, then we are not attenders. We are not spectators. We are not onlookers. We are not an audience. We are members and we are part of a mission, people who have a purpose, people who have a job to do. That's what I think the first couple of verses there are teaching, verses 7 and 8. All right, the next three verses tell us why being a member instead of just an attender matters. Look at verses 9 through 11. This grace was given to me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ, verse 9, and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, we'll come back to that word, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. God's intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word mystery is probably the first one that jumps off the page to you. It kind of catches your eye. Everybody likes a mystery. We watch them on Netflix. We read them on our tablets at the beach. I'm going to ask you to totally disregard all of those contemporary associations we make with the word mystery. That's not what Paul has in mind. In his Jewish lexicon, the word does not refer to a concept that is difficult to understand or to a story about a puzzling crime. Mystery, in Paul's world, referred to something that could only be known if God revealed it. Mystery was something that could only exist if it had come from the mind of God, God's idea and God's alone, something that came from the mind of God and only God could reveal. So what was the thing? Paul says that my job is to proclaim this mystery. What was the thing that only God could come up with, only God could reveal? Verse 10, here it is. Here's the big one. God's plan from the beginning was to display his eternal wisdom through the church, which we greet with about as much enthusiasm as a baked potato. You mean God's plan from before the creation of the world was to pull together a collection of sometimes not so lovable misfits and use us to display his wisdom to the spiritual powers in the universe and to communicate his love to the world. That's the plan. Did you ever see the movie Stand By Me? Or The Breakfast Club, or The Bad News Bears, or Napoleon Dynamite, am I getting warmer? The Avengers, have you watched the television series The Walking Dead? Every one of those and dozens more play on the same ancient theme. A group of dissimilar people band together, and together become something far greater than any one of them could have become alone. That storyline was God's idea. And it's not just a story. It's not just a movie. It's real. It's the church. God wants you to be a part of that story. God wants you to be an active member of his church. And I don't just mean the universal church, the one that C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters said was spread out through all space and eternity, terrible as an army marching with banners. Everybody wants to be a part of that church. God wants you to be a part of one of the local affiliates. God wants you to be a member at the branch office. The Bible simply does not know anything about, I said earlier, it doesn't know anything about unemployed Christians. It doesn't know anything about at-large Christians either. It never talks about unchurched Christians. The New Testament norm, the biblical norm, is for people who believe in Jesus to band together, worship together, work together, and learn how to live in love together. Membership matters, because when a disparate group of people who have nothing more in common than their common belief in Jesus Christ, when they come together as a community, it demonstrates to the world the wisdom and power of God. Paul says here in Ephesians 2 that even the spiritual forces sit up and take notice. That's why what we talked about last week was so important. This whole Jews and Gentiles, blacks and whites and Asians and Hispanics getting along together in the church, that's why that matters. Because it demonstrates to the world and to the spiritual powers that our God knows what He's doing and He's got the power to make it come true. We make a huge statement about God when we function as members in a healthy church. Okay, basically, you got two points this morning. You need to be a part of a church. That's the first point. We would actually like it to be this one. You're here. Seems like that'd be an obvious next step. But we also, the other point that we have here is that you need to be active. You want to be a part of a church and you want to be active in that church. We're trying to do something tangible with that today. We've purchased a book called I Am a Church Member by Tom Rainer. These are in the lobby, and we bought enough for one for every family. If you're a guest today, just pick one up. For your family. But happy for you to have it. If we need more, we'll order them. This is the book is not difficult to read, okay? You know some authors you pick up and you can tell they've written with a very sesquipedalian approach, using a lot of big words to make you think they're really smart. This is not one of those books. This is a really accessible book. If you read slowly, you can probably be through this in about an hour. We're trying to give you something tangible to hold on to and to help fill out this idea of being an active member in the Church of Jesus Christ. So pick one of these up today. I'd love for you to read it, give you some feedback on email, jody@twickenham.org, and let us know what you think about it. There are some pledges that he asks people to make in here, some pledges about what kind of church member you're going to be. I want to challenge you to take a look at that and take those. And if you will, if we will do this together, this church will change. But more than that, we'll change this community. If we get really serious about why we're here and who we're supposed to be, we are the Church of Jesus Christ. We are not perfect. We are sinners saved by His grace, and we are created in Christ Jesus to do good works. And when we do those good works, we bear fruit through the power of the Spirit. You get into this, you let this get into you, you'll see some changes. Huge. Sounded like Donald Trump there, didn't I? Okay. Last thing. Verse 12. Paul says, in Jesus and through faith in Him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. I worry there's somebody in the room this morning that doesn't feel like they can approach God with freedom and confidence. Maybe you're afraid of Him because of something you've done. Maybe you doubt you're good enough to approach Him. Can I just say again and again what Paul has said? It's not about what you have done. It's about what He has done for you. I love it that Paul says we can approach God with freedom and confidence. We're not free because of the work we do for God. We're free because of the work God has done for us in Jesus Christ. We don't approach God with confidence because we're such busy and effective workers in the church. We're able to approach God with confidence because of the mission He undertook, which was our salvation. But we are free, and we can be confident. We are part of something that God planned before creation. He's been working to save us from sin and save us for His purpose for a long, long time. No other God you serve is going to do that. No other God is going to dream about you before you even exist. No other God is going to refuse to give up on you when you fail. No other God is going to go to a cross, lie in a tomb, and rise victorious in order to give you a hope and a future and a purpose. But our God did that for us. We're special, not because of who we are and what we've done. We're special because of what He has done. Let's stand, let's sing about that together. Praise Him for it.
We come to bow before You now.
We come to lay our lives down.
We will have no other gods before You.
Nothing on earth will compete for Your throne.
You are the sovereign I am, and You reign in our hearts alone.
We will exalt You on high forever,
King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
We will have no other gods before You.
We will have no other gods before You.
Nothing on earth will compete for Your throne.
You are the sovereign I am, and You reign in our hearts alone.
We will exalt You on high forever,
King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
We will have no other gods before You.
Can I get you to sit down real quick for just a second? We got a little bit of a family business we got to take care of here. Richard and Denise Seabolt have been with Twickenham for a lot of years. In fact, 14 years, and this is their last Sunday. I always hate to see folks go, but especially folks that have been involved and loved and done so many of the things they've done. Let me just read a quick excerpt here that they sent to one of our elders this week. 14 years ago, Richard and me, God richly blessed Richard and me when He brought us to the Twickenham Church. Moving to Alabama from Iowa, okay, was a difficult move. Having left our home, family, and church family behind, our friends in Iowa had been praying that we would be able to find a church family in Alabama, and it was God who brought us here to you. Richard and I knew this was where we belonged from the moment Tim Logan laid his hands on our shoulders and said a prayer over us in Bible class on our first visit. So, will you guys stand? Where are you? You're right over here somewhere. Oh, here you are. We love you guys. We're going to miss you. We're praying for you. They are moving back to Iowa. They'll be with grandkids, and so we love you guys. And Ron's going to come up and lead us in a prayer for them and for our missionaries, and just to close us out today. Let's go ahead and stand, please, and he'll lead us in a prayer.
Before we close, it sure is nice to be back home. We moved here 7 years ago, and I can't believe it's been that long. Moved back to Texas to spend the last 3 years of my father's life with him, and we've moved back. Thank you for being such a welcoming, loving church body. We love you. We love worshiping with you. Let's close out today in remembrance of this wonderful hour of worship. Would you please bow with me? Father God, whew, what an hour. We know that You alone are worthy of our praise. We've sung to You today that we rise up. You are our Alpha and our Omega. We believe that You are our all. We've learned today that the Christian walk is a team sport, and that what compels us to the team is Christ's love. Thank You for Justin and John and the mission that they have in Ecuador, taking care of the young children and making a difference, spreading Your word one person at a time, making a difference. Pray for those, Father, today that have been hurt by the church. We ask You to forgive us, forgive our hypocrisy and our criticisms. We are a broken people. Teach us, Father, that church is not an event, but it is our entire lives. It is our mission and our ministry. Your grace gives us a purpose and a job to serve. Help us to do good works, revealing that manifold mystery of the kingdom of God to all those around us. So guide us as we band together to become something greater than we are alone. And we are to be active members of this wonderful body at Twickenham. Father, please be with the leaders, be with our ministers, be with our teachers, our missionaries, which is each and every one of us, and reveal to us, Father, our identity to change this church and change this community. Be with us as we depart this time and we go about living our lives of worship to you. In Jesus' holy name, the church says, amen. Amen.